anterior chamber assessment, more emphasis will be on gonioscopy and role of imaging in angle closure glaucoma. So first we'll be starting with torchlight examination. In this, a pen torch is shown at the level of the eyeball from the temporal canthus, and depending on the iris that is illuminated, it is graded. Grade 1 is when less than 1/3 of iris is illuminated. Grade 2 is when 1/3 to 2/3 of iris is illuminated. Grade 3 is when more than 2/3 of iris is illuminated, and grade 4 is when fully illuminated iris is seen. More common technique that people use for grading anterior chamber depth is Van Herrick's technique on slit lamp. So size of an optic section width on the cornea is compared to the gap between section and the reflection on the iris. Beam is trained just within the limbus at an angle of 60 degrees, and the corneal thickness and the dark optical section is compared and graded from 1 to 4. So grade 1 is when peripheral anterior chamber depth is less than 1/4 the corneal thickness. When it is equal to 1/4 corneal thickness, it is grade 2. When it is half to 1/4 to half corneal thickness, it is grade 3. And when it is more than or equal to corneal thickness, it is grade 4. But when we grade it from 1 to 4, we can miss subtle changes. Hence, a decimal scale was introduced. And this scale was from 0 to grade 1. And 0 being no dark section is visible at all, that is there is iridocorneal contact. And grade 1 being 1:1 ratio, that is the optically dark section is equal to the limbal section. Now let's come to gonioscopy. So the principle of gonioscopy is based on the fact that the refractive index of air is less than the tear film. So according to Snell's law, this interface leads to total internal reflection, as the light going from a more dense medium to a less dense medium is refracted away from the normal. When this reaches a critical angle of 46 degrees, there is internal reflection. Hence, we are not able to visualize the angle without use of any gonio prisms or indentation. That is why we use indirect gonio lenses. So the light rays are reflected by a mirror or prism in the contact lens and leave the lens at nearly a right angle to the contact lens air interface. The lenses that we use are Goldman single mirror, 3 mirror, Zeiss 4 mirror, Posner and Sussman 4 mirror lenses. Now the difference between Goldman mirror lenses and Zeiss is that the diameter of a Goldman mirror lens is less than that of a 4 mirror lens, and the diameter is less of the Zeiss 4 mirror lens. That is why it's able to do indentation gonioscopy on patients. Advantages of Goldman gonioscope is that easy for beginners, it gives a clearer view. But disadvantage is that it requires coupling agent and indentation gonioscopy is not possible, and you can have suction abrasions. In Zeiss type of gonio lens, no coupling agent is required and indentation gonioscopy is possible. However, it requires expertise and patient cooperation. Now, how do we perform a gonioscopy? So there should be comfortable seating both for the examiner and for the patient. The examiner's elbow should be well rested. Adjust the slit lamp chin rest so that the lateral canthus of the patient is in line with the canthal marker on the slit lamp. This permits vertical excursion of the slit lamp and gives you better gonioscopic view. Explain procedure to the patient, instill topical anesthetic drops, switch off room light and limit the light entering the examination room. Patient eyes should be in primary gaze and you should place the gonio lens. Magnification can be low to high depending the detail that you're looking for. Short slit lamp lens should be there and it should be directed away from the pupillary area. Slit lamp illuminating unit should be at an angle of 45 degrees. Perform procedure with ease so that the patient is not discomforted. And indentation gonioscopy, you have to exert pressure on the gonio lens and note the angle structures after indentation. If single mirror gonio lens is used, then rotate lens to cover 360 degrees. Now to get started while seeing the structures, the foremost important thing is that we have to locate the Schwalbe's line. Contrary to what we normally do, that if there is pigmentation, we take it as trabecular meshwork, which can be falsely misleading and we can miss angle closure, as sometimes the Schwalbe's line can also be pigmented. So here we look at the place where this sharp line, that is from the internal part of the eye to the fuzzy margin, that is from the external part of the eye, where these light beams meet is the Schwalbe's line, and the angle has to be then tracked forwards. So once we have located the Schwalbe's line in an open angle, the next structure that we will be seeing is a brownish colored line, that will be the trabecular meshwork, followed by a white band, that will be scleral spur, and a gray band, that will be the ciliary body band. Now, how do we classify the angle? So there is Speeth classification, who took into account the iris insertion, angular approach of the iris, peripheral iris configuration, and pigmentation of the trabecular meshwork. Iris insertion was graded as A, B, C, D, E based on whether it was inserted anterior to Schwall baseline, between the Schwall baseline or scleral spur, at the whether the scleral spur was visible, deep with ciliary body visible, and extremely deep with more than 1 mm of ciliary body being visible. Peripheral iris configuration was given name as regular, that is R, whether it was flat. If steep, then it was divided into two categories, whether it bowed anteriorly or it was plateau iris, and queer if it is concave. Pigmentation of trabecular meshwork was graded from no pigment at all to 4 plus, that is intense pigmentation. Shee's classification gave us grade 1 as iris root being visible, grade 2 ciliary body obscured, grade 3 was when posterior trabeculum was obscured, and grade 4 when only Schwall baseline was visible. Schaefer's system, the grade 4 was 35 to 45 degree of angle recess and all the structures were visible till the root of iris. Grade 3 is 20 degree to 35 degree of angle recess and wide open angle up to scleral spur. Grade 2 is 20 degree of angle recess and angle was narrow with visible trabecular meshwork. Grade 1 is 10 degree of angle recess and occurs when angle was extremely narrow. Grade 0 is when no angle structures were visible. However, clinically we note these findings in the form of a cross and we see whatever structure is seen, we note it down. And on indentation, if we are able to further open up the angle, then an arrow is put and the opened up angle, whatever structure it is there, we mention. Side by side, we can also mention specific findings like peripheral anterior synechiae and the pigmentation of the trabecular meshwork. Now, this is a photograph of a peripheral anterior synechiae. In the first picture, a no angle structure can be seen, so it is a total peripheral anterior synechiae in that quadrant. If you compare this to the second picture, you can see that an angle recess is visible. However, the iris is stuck to the Schwall base line and this is called a tented peripheral anterior synechiae. This is a photograph of an iris process. You can see fine iris processes, but the angle is wide open. This should not be mistaken for anterior synechiae, and it's very important to differentiate this from a peripheral anterior synechiae. So what are the differences between the two? In iris processes, it is fine. They extend up to the scleral spur. They follow concavity of the recess. Underlying structures are seen. Iris moves with indentation and it's broken with angle recession. However, pars, they are broad. They extend beyond scleral spur. They bridge the concavity. It obscures the view, resists movements, and it's intact in recession. This is a photograph of plateau iris. So you can see that there is a sine wave configuration seen on gonioscopy. That is because of the anteriorly rotated ciliary body which is pushing the peripheral iris forward. This is a video of over the hill view. So a patient had Van Herrick's grade 2. However, without indentation, just on looking above the iris, we are able to see a deeply pigmented trabecular meshwork. So this is not actually closed angle. There was no evidence of iridotrabecular contact in this patient. This is a video of indentation gonioscopy. Here on indenting, we are able to differentiate appositional angle closure from... Okay, I'm sorry, the video is not playing. I'll show you in the end. So basically here we'll be able to differentiate between appositional angle closure and synechial angle closure. So initially, as you can see, no angle structures are seen. On indenting, we are not able to see any structure, and we can see that the iris is attached to the angles. So this is a case of peripheral anterior synechiae. Now a small case wherein we had seen a patient, 40-year-old male, who complained of left eye sudden diminution of vision, consulted multiple ophthalmologists for more than a month, was on topical antibiotic steroid drops, topical anti-glaucoma medication. His right eye showed a shallow anterior segment, left eye showed a hazy cornea, and Van Herrick's was grade 0. And we saw a question, right eye, maybe it was query plateau iris. However, it was completely missed because gonioscopy was not done and no PI was attempted in this patient. So tips, gonioscope all your glaucoma patients. Don't just rely on Van Herrick's. Practice on contact lens wearers in your initial time so that you can get a more comfortable viewing of the angle. Comfortable seating position is very important. Patient counseling is very important before you start the procedure. While beginning gonioscopy, start with Goldman type lenses and then go to Zeiss type mirror. Now, small bit detail about imaging. So ultrasound biomicroscopy can be used for angle closure glaucoma. It gives us certain parameters in various algorithms, one of them being angle opening distance 500. This is basically from a point 500 microns from a scleral spur, a perpendicular is dropped to the iris and this distance is noted. Another important parameter in terms of angle closure is transciliary process distance. So it is a perpendicular which is dropped from 500 microns from the scleral spur to the ciliary process. Then we also have angle closure, angle opening distance of 250, which is a measure of the angle opening at the level of posterior trabecular meshwork. Angle opening distance at 500 gives us a measure of angle opening at the level of anterior Schwall baseline. So angle opening distance measured by UBM may thus reflect the amount of relative pupillary block in eyes with narrow angles. Findings in angle closure in UBM, it has enabled many clinicians to quantitatively assess the iris curvature and degree of angle opening. Relative pupillary block results in anterior bored iris with a corresponding decrease in angle opening, and the angle opening distance measured by UBM may thus reflect the amount of relative pupillary block. TCPD, that is trabecular ciliary process distance, defines the space between iris, between the trabecular meshwork and the ciliary process. An anteriorly placed ciliary process or a thick iris can reduce the peripheral anterior chamber depth and make it susceptible to occlusion, which will be seen in plateau iris configuration. What are the drawbacks? UBM measurement of angle structure can be influenced by variation in image acquisition, inconsistency in alignment and failure to control accommodation and room illumination, inter-observer variability. It can be time-consuming and it is more of a research tool than diagnostic. Advantages of UBM in angle closure is diagnosing plateau iris and in cases of corneal haze and opacity. Now the AS-OCT also gave us various biometric parameters, one of them being angle opening distance, another one of significance is iris thickness, iris curvature and lens vault. What are the disadvantages of AS-OCT in diagnosing angle closure? It has poor agreement with gonioscopic findings, poor reproducibility of AS-OCT findings in the inferior quadrant, structures posterior to iris pigment epithelium cannot be visualized, and variables such as eye quadrant, small AC depth, narrow angle, shorter axial length and older age can all increase difficulty of an accurate identification of scleral spur. What are the advantages? It is non-contact. Anterior segment imaging can acquire objective parameters and data that are not possible with clinical examination, and anterior segment imaging can help elucidate mechanisms of glaucoma not possible with standard clinical examinations. AS-OCT, and there are a few evolving concepts in angle closure. So like Karishma mentioned, there is a lot of research going on iris area, iris thickness. So there was a study conducted and it was noticed that quantitative iris parameters like curvature, area, thickness are independently associated with narrow angles, particularly in women and older age. So these data provide further insight into pathogenesis of angle closure in Singaporeans. Another study was done wherein the lens wall, lens thickness and lens position was studied in context with angle closure. So it was noted that patients with angle closure had greater lens vault. This can also form basis for many that lens extraction is one of the modalities of treating angle closure. However, at the end, I would like to say that gonioscopy is the gold standard to diagnose angle closure. It has an important role in cases of plateau iris. Imaging is an ancillary tool for documentation, patient education and research. And lastly, there is a tale I found it on the internet by a glaucoma consultant from Hubli, M.M. Joshi. So there is a tale about elephant and blind men. Now here, elephant is burden of angle closure in our community. And blind men and women are ophthalmologists without gonioscopy. Thank you.